Amen. You know, I recently retired, so I don't drive as much as I used to, but lately since I've been driving, have you noticed that people have just have abandoned the right of way? have you noticed that? Because I was taught that if I'm in the far right lane, I'm making a turn, and if someone's coming, oncoming traffic, and they want to make a turn, they're supposed to wait for me until I turn, right? Is that right? But we have just abandoned that. Right away doesn't mean what it used to mean. I've been driving and going straight, making a turn. I even had cars turn in front of me. I'm thinking, like, what is going on here? We just don't obey the traffic laws like we used to. We got to navigate so much, and even as a pedestrian, you know, you get to a light and it's red. You're supposed to wait, amen, until it turns green. But folk don't do that anymore. We just barrel on as though everybody is supposed to wait for us. We got to navigate the traffic. We got to navigate the cars, motorcycles, and all kind of stuff in our lives.
Yes.
And the crosswalks are designed for our protection. Amen. Some of them are marked with lines, and there's a length of the crosswalk, and also some lights, and some of them have timers. The timer means that when that timer goes off, you need to hurry up, amen? You need to speed up. And then that leads me to my topic today, because one thing that bothers me when I'm driving, if I get to a red light or get to a green light and there's a pedestrian who has a red light, who won't wait, who will just walk in front of me when I'm ready to turn. That just bothers me to no end, because we have abandoned the right of way. So I want to talk from the title today, Run, Don't Walk. Run, don't walk. Because when I'm crossing the street, if the light is about to turn red, I at least have the courtesy to at least run and not hold up traffic. Amen. I mean, I can still run a little bit. So I will run across the street to make sure I don't hold up the people who are behind me or trying to get to the next light or next station. And I've discovered that you and I as Christians have, in some ways, abandoned the right of way. And we're like a lot of pedestrians. We are walking when we should be running. Amen. Because time is short. We're living in times today where norms are not what they used to be. Things are pretty chaotic in our climate today. Yeah. And so there is an urgency upon you and I to hurry up, to stop walking and start running. Because we know that one day we're going to see Jesus face to face, and the last thing we want to be is lagging behind when we should be up front. So the text that was read earlier by Minister Williams is Hebrews chapter 12, 1 and 4. I'll just read it again for your hearing. It reads, Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. And it says run, don't walk. It says run. With endurance, the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endures such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. You have not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin. Let us pray. Our Father God, we thank you today for your presence. We thank you for every person that purpose in their heart to be here today. You know their needs, you know where they should be, and I pray, my Father, that you would speak to me and through me. and that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart would be acceptable in thy sight. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. So again, the topic today is run, don't walk. There is an urgency upon us to hurry up, to speed up. Some of us are too busy leisurely walking through life and we're missing what God has called us to do. When I look at this text, I think about a quote that was passed on to the late great Kobe Bryant. He said his high school coach told him this: rest at the end, not in the middle. And those of you who know the story of life of Kobe Bryant, he was that kind of person. He gave it his all until the very end. And when I look at this text, it highlights that we have a motivation to move and to maintain momentum. And so the question I have for you today, what moves you? What motivates you? What got you up this morning to come to church this morning? And the text talks about a great cloud of witnesses. And some translation says great crowd. But we have to be careful when we start this journey that we lag behind, because there's a danger in lagging behind Jesus, because you allow a whole lot of stuff to get between you and him. So if I'm going to be effective in my Christian journey, I need to make sure that I'm up close and personal with my Savior, Jesus Christ, not allowing anything to get in between he and I. So the text says we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. And if you take the time to read chapter 11, it talks about some of those great witnesses who passed on before us, who are in the clouds, figuratively speaking, reminding us that we have a mission, we have a journey, we have a responsibility, and we can only accomplish that by faith. So in that great cloud of witnesses is Abel, amen, and Noah and Abraham and Moses and David. All those individuals who went before us are in that great cloud of witnesses. Now, if you look at it as a crowd, you and I have to be careful about the crowd or the company we keep. Because the crowd can do more harm than help you, amen? And so this cloud of witnesses will help you. But you have to be careful about the crowd you're running with right now and ask yourself, is this the crowd that's going to help me get to where I need to be? But the text says we have witnesses, a great cloud of witnesses who are reminding us that because they overcame, we can overcome also. Those are our witnesses, not just the crowd or the cloud, but also Christ in the text is our witness, amen. Because he overcame, we also can overcome, amen. But also we have a crown. I'm running, yes, because I have a great cloud of witnesses. I'm running because Jesus Christ is my forerunner, but also he promised me a crown. So I have a motivation to move, amen, to get to that finish line. And so my hope today is to encourage someone today is to stay motivated. Because in times like this, it's easy to get discouraged when political climate is in an uproar and the racism is on the rise and people are doing this and people are doing that. It's easy to get discouraged as a child of God. And so I'm here to encourage you to stay motivated, but also to increase the pace, amen, of the race. You've been leisurely walking around thinking you got all day and all time to do what God has called you to do. No, you don't, amen. None of us know the day and hour when he's going to call our name to say, come on home. So until then, I ought to be running and not walking and being about my Father's business. So I encourage you today is to stay motivated, amen, and to increase the pace of the race. Now, it says also that we ought to consider one another to stir up to love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, amen, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as we see the day approaching. Church participation or church attendance is important, amen. This is our training ground, amen. This is where we hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ and are encouraged to do what God has called us to do. And I know some people think they can do church, you know, online or in their bed. Yes, you can, but you're not going to be effective as a child of God unless you are planted and seated in his house of prayer. So church attendance is our training ground. So I am encouraging you to stay motivated. And when I look at this text and I think about what are the processes for you and I to stay motivated? The first process in this text I see is we have to pull off. It says lay aside every weight and sin. You know, the Olympics are going on, and those who watch the Olympics know about the great sprinter Usain Bolt. He had a quote, he said this. He says, I trained for 4 years to run 9 seconds, and people give up when they don't see results in 2 months. That is a lot of us. We give up when we don't see that God is moving as we think he should. But we gotta pull that off, amen. That old mindset has to be laid aside, because God made some promises to you and I, and God always keeps his promises. Yes. So even though you may not see results right now, keep, amen, moving forward in the Lord Jesus Christ. But you gotta pull off. And there's two things you need to pull off according to this text. It says you need to pull off the weight and the sin. It's hard to run when you're carrying a lot of baggage. Yes. Yes. Y'all can talk back to me, amen. Amen. We're family, this is home. It's hard to be effective when you're carrying a lot of baggage. Yes, and sir. I blessed to take a few trips every now and then with my wife, and those who taken trips with their significant other know that the men can testify that our bags are a lot smaller than their bags, amen. They carry a whole lot of stuff with them that I normally don't take with us. A whole lot of excess baggage in my mind, but that's just my opinion, Mike. She's not here to defend herself, so I could say that. But a whole lot of baggage. And it's hard for you and I to run the race that Christ or the passage is highlighting when we're carrying a lot of baggage. And that's that weight. It could be the baggage of bitterness, the baggage of resentment, amen. The baggage of unforgiveness. You can't run effectively when you carry around unforgiveness, amen. That's excess baggage, amen. And you got to pull that off, amen. He says lay aside every weight. And you know, if you look at the Olympics today, as opposed to the days of old, they used to run in long pants and just a whole lot of excess clothing. But now they're almost like half, really, they're not covered up much these days. You know what I'm trying to say? Because they know that they need as little resistance as possible to be effective. Yes. That same mindset ought to apply to you and I. We got to be careful about getting caught up in materialism. Yes, I like nice things. We all like nice things. But you got to be careful that those material things don't become baggage and hinder you from being what God has called you to be. So you got to lay aside, you got to pull off the baggage, amen. All of that stuff, amen, you got to pull it off. And I love the quote, the scripture talks about, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go by it, because narrow is the gate, and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. You can't get to that gate with a whole lot of stuff on you, amen. You got to put it off. And a quote by Dr. King, which I always has been heavy on my heart, he says, whenever men and women straighten their backs up, he says they're going somewhere, because a man can't ride your back unless it is bent. Amen. So you can't be effective if you're carrying a lot of stuff on you, amen. So sometimes you got to shake it off, amen. Some folk, you just got to shake them off, amen. You got to pull off the baggage, amen, if you're going to be effective in this race that God has called us to. But not just the baggage, amen. You got to pull off the blame. He says, and the sin. Mm-hmm. Now, I didn't come here to get personal, amen, which we know what sin is. And people say, why do we sin? We sin because it feels good. We wouldn't do it if it didn't feel good, amen. Would you do it if it felt good? No, we sin because it we enjoy it. But he says, you got to lay aside the weight and the sin. And you know what that is in your life. But I don't want you to focus on the sin. I want you to focus on the blame. Because a lot of us are not effective in our Christian journey because we're blaming ourselves for stuff. Amen. We count a lot of regret. But the book says there is no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. God, if you're a child of his, he does not condemn you for your sins. Your sins have already been paid for by Jesus Christ on the cross. So you can't carry that blame around, because that blame will hinder you from being effective. Amen. And so when it's time for you to run, you can't run because you got so much regret hanging over your shoulders. So you gotta pull off the baggage, but you also gotta pull off the blame. Amen. You gotta pull it off. The second process in this text, after you pull off the baggage and the blame, you gotta pick up. He says, looking unto Jesus, amen, the author and finisher of our faith. It says, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame. Jesus is our pace setter. Yeah. Amen. He's the one that goes before us and determines how fast we ought to be running this race. If you looked at any car races where they have a pace setter car, or if you look at some long distance runners, they have a pace setter because they want to make sure everybody's moving as fast as they possibly can. Jesus is our pace setter. And if he's running ahead of us, we better sure make sure we try to keep up. Amen. Don't lag behind, because we're missing someone if we don't keep up. So we got to make sure, amen, that we pick up. And I can't pick up until I have pulled off what those things that are hindering me. So there's two things we need to pick up according to this text, or in the mindset of the Olympics, is the baton. You all see relay races, amen? Where, you know, one runner passes to the next runner, to the next runner. The cloud of witnesses have passed the baton to you and I. Have you picked it up? Have you picked it up? Some of us, you know, we see it. It's just laying there on the ground, amen? We're not ready to pick it up. I don't want to pick that up, amen? That means I have to run too. Yes, it does. But Jesus is encouraging you and I to pick up the baton. Amen. And not just for you, but for future generations. Yes. Yes. For your children. Yes. For your grandchildren. Yes. Amen. For your great-grandchildren. Amen. You got to pick up that baton so you can pass it to the next generation. Amen. That's what the cloud of witnesses did for you and I. Yes. They ran and they passed the baton to you and I, but we got to pick it up. Yes. We got to pick it up. And one of the movies that I think about when I was preparing for this text is the movie Forrest Gump. You all know that movie, amen? And Forrest just ran everywhere. And at one particular scene, he's just running and running, and someone asked him, why are you running? And his response was, for no particular reason, I just felt like running. But he said, he got to the end and said, I'm pretty tired. I think I'll go home now. When you don't have a purpose for running, you'll stop for anything, amen? You don't have a reason, so you don't have a purpose. And so when things get difficult, you'll just stop and go home. But it ain't time for you and I to go home. That's coming later when Jesus returns. And so we have to make sure that we understand why we're running. What's our motivation? What compels us? What moves us to do what God has called us to do? And in order for us to know that, we got to make sure we're participating in the process. Amen. I got to make sure that I pull off the stuff, but I also need to make sure I pick up some stuff. And the only way I can pick up some stuff is I got to pull off some stuff, amen? And the only way, until I pull off some stuff, I'm not going to pick up some stuff, amen? You say, how can I carry the baton? You can't carry it if you're carrying a lot of baggage, amen? That's why you need to pull it off, amen? And then you can pick up the baton. But not just the baton, you also need to recognize that there is a beacon in one hand. There is a baton in one hand and a beacon in the other. If you watch the Olympics, in the start of the Olympics, there's someone who's carrying that torch to light the start of the games. The Bible says that you and I are the light of the world. That's what Jesus said. He says, you and I are lights in this world. And if I have a light, I don't put it under a basket, amen. I hold it high for others to see. So on one hand, I got the baton, amen. On the other hand, I got the beacon. Yes, I'm ready to pass to the other generation, but if they don't see no light, amen, they ain't going to see the baton, amen. So they need to make sure they see the light of Christ living in us and through us. And that light is important. That light signifies that I am a child of God. Now, if you look at that passage in Matthew, where it talks about us being a light in this world, but also he says we're the salt of the earth. And I heard a preacher say that a lot of us want to be the light of the world, but we don't want to be the salt of the earth. Amen. We want all the attention, but we don't want to do the work. Amen. They go hand in hand. You can't be light without being salt. Amen. But so the two things we need to pick up are the baton and the beacon. Amen. We got to pick those things up. Amen. The third process in this text is we need to pull off, we need to pick up, then we need to press on. For it says there, lest you become discouraged in your souls. When I said earlier, it's easy to become disheartened or discouraged in times like these. And you want to say, can things get better? Yes, they can, because God is still sovereign. I don't care what's going on in this world today. Please know this beyond a shadow of a doubt. God is still in control. He's still on the throne, amen. He's still pulling things and making things happen. God is still in control. So I got to press on. And it says in this text that Jesus was able to press on because of the joy that was set before him. That's in the passage. That's how he was able to endure the shame, amen, and endure all the ugliness that he went through, because he knew that he was going to sit down at the right hand of his Father. But that promise is made to you and I too, amen. We ought to be running for the joy that has been set down before us, amen, because God had made promises to us. And in John 14, 2 and 4, it says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, amen. He said, I'm going to prepare a place for you that where I am, you may be also. That's a promise to the child of God. So when I'm running, I'm recognizing I'm running, yes, because I got a cloud of witnesses. I'm running, yes, because Christ is my pace setter. But also I'm running because I know there's a crown waiting for me. And the Bible says it's a crown of righteousness. It's a crown of glory. It's an incorruptible crown that he promised to me. He promised to me. So I don't know where you are today, and when I think about pressing on, I got to press on through the blow. And when I say that, I mean the wind. And the wind, I mean the headwind that is constantly coming my direction. There are forces out there that are pressing against you to keep you from moving forward. And that there be no doubt in your mind. The Bible says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and stuff that you cannot see. So there is a wind blowing against us. So I got to make sure I press on even through the wind, amen, even through the opposing motion that's coming my direction. My wife and I recently saw the movie Twister, the new one. You all might have said the old one. I saw the old one and the new one. And I looked at this movie and stuff was just flying all kind of ways and coming all different directions. And I thought about sometimes that's how I feel. Stuff was just flying at me and I'm trying to dodge and, you know, duck and weave and bob and all that stuff, trying to get out the way. That's how life is, amen. God never promised us this would be easy. Sometimes we have to duck and weave, amen. We got to bob, amen. We may have to throw a few punches if need be, amen. But we got to be careful of the obstacles that are coming our way, because stuff is blowing our way on a constant, continual basis, amen. And we got to make sure that we understand we have to be aware of the obstacles, but also the objections. Anybody ain't happy that you happy? Everybody ain't happy that you happy. Amen. So you got to deal with some objections, amen. Sometimes from family, from friends, from coworkers who don't share your conviction, amen. And that's something you have to deal with. Another movie reference, you know, I watch little movies every now and then, Shawshank Redemption, one of my favorite movies also, is that when Morgan Freeman was talking to Tim Robbins and they were debating about life in general, and Morgan Freeman was telling him to just give up the dream of getting out. And he responded to him, he said, either I can get busy living or get busy dying. Think about that. What are you doing? Are you consumed with dying or are you consumed with living? You know, I'm consumed with living until Jesus comes, amen. And so there's a constant motion in my life to move forward and not to stand still. Amen. I'm compelled to do something for him because I enjoy my life in the Lord Jesus Christ. And when it's time to go home, I'll go home. But until then, amen, I got to run. And I ain't got time to be walking around as though I got don't have a care in the world. So I got to deal with that. I got to deal with the blows that are constantly coming my way and to recognize that I'm on a battlefield. I'm on a battlefield, amen. When you're pressing on, recognize you're on a battlefield, amen. And the battlefield sometimes gets ugly, amen. It gets ugly sometimes, amen. It gets ugly. But I like the song that says, I'm on the battlefield for my Lord, and I promise him that I will serve him until I die. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. Are you on the battlefield? Because when you're on the battlefield, sometimes things get a little bloody. And the text says here, you have not yet resisted to the shedding of blood. You know, oftentimes we equate difficult times as persecution. Not like the apostles went through. We haven't been through that kind of persecution. But there may come a time where that is, where there may be some bloodshed. And so you got to recognize when you're on the battlefield, yes, you could get a little bloody, amen, but you got to press on. You got to press on. And as I close, I want you to think about this. If you've done any running or walking and you've seen people or you're driving, you see someone running just out for exercise, and every now and then they get to a light and the light is red. And I see these individuals get to a light and they just keep running in place. Running in place until the light changes. I said, why are they doing that? They're doing that because they don't want to lose their momentum. Amen. That's what you and I have to do. We don't want to lose our momentum. Even when we come to a red light and we got to wait, I don't want to lose my momentum, but I'm thankful for what the Bible says, that those who wait on the Lord, amen, shall renew their strength. So when I get a little tired, if I wait on God, he'll renew my strength, amen, amen. And I can mount up like with wings like eagles, amen. I can run and not be weary. I can walk and not faint when I wait on him, because Jesus is my mentor, but he's also my Messiah, amen. And he's also my crossing guard. So when I get to a situation that's difficult and there's a lot of traffic, I can see Jesus as my crossing guard to get me to the other side, amen. And I can lean on him, I can depend on him, because he is the author, amen, and the finisher of the race I'm already running, amen. He's already done it, amen. I need to make sure I follow him. So when we participate in the process, we can press towards the prize for the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. So I'm here today to encourage you to stay motivated, amen, and pick up the pace, amen. Be in a hurry to be about God's business, amen, because there are people that are dependent upon you, and I trust that you have decided to lean in to what God has called you to do. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, how grateful we are for your word, for the encouragement, for the motivation to do what you have called us to do. I pray, oh God, that this word would find a permanent place in the hearts of your hearers and bring forth fruit to thy praise and to thy glory. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So we're going to take a moment to extend the Lord Jesus Christ. I know when Brother Chris mentioned that we have any visitors, I know the two, Roberto's brother and mom are here, but if there's others who are here who haven't made that commitment to receive Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, we don't want to be remiss and conclude that everybody that comes to God's house knows him. And so we take the time to extend the opportunity for someone who wants to make that decision to say, yes, I want Christ to be the center of my life. I want him on the throne of my life. I acknowledge that he died for my sins. Yes, he was buried. But he rose from the grave, and as he promised, he's coming back again. Amen. That's a promise from him. And so if you're compelled or the Spirit is moving upon you and you haven't made that decision, amen, we thank God for the opportunity that we give every Sunday for someone to receive the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, we have done what God has called us to do. We want to prepare our hearts and minds for communion. We thank God for Deacon Jones and the ushers. It's helpful, you know, to those who want to participate in communion if we could all come to one section, amen. It's easier for us to serve you. And communion is a sacred moment in the church because it's a reminder to you and I of the price that was paid for our salvation. And we're thankful for that. Mr. Williams is going to come with a scripture reading, and then we will proceed.